Good morning. Good morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord and good to be back with Mississippi Avenue. Let's stand and worship the Lord this morning. I have a home.
I have a home
that will never fade away.
That will never fade away.
He's alive in me. Shall be the flame. The flame shall not burn thee. I only design thy dross to console, and I go to refine the soul that on Jesus have leaned for repose. I will not desert to his foes. That soul.
y'all. You may be seated. As I pray, I just ask for you to pray for two things. The first thing would be that we have a mission team who are headed right now to Vidor, Texas. They're doing some disaster recovery there. Now, you can be in a special prayer for him. He is one of my students at Gateway Seminary, so pray for the mission team. Pray for him as he takes my class. We're blessed to have him here today, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, it is just a rich blessing to be called by your name, to be called your child. And Father, we just ask for you to bless and anoint our services today. We confess that we need you. We need you to show up. We need you to be here. We need your spirit to move. Father, bless those who need blessing. Encourage those who need encouraging. And convict those who need convicting this morning. In a moment, as the children lead us in worship, may we be reminded of the type of faith that we're supposed to come to you with. So, Father, we ask, if anybody here this morning doesn't know you as Savior and Lord, that you will speak to them. And, Father, bless the mission team and their endeavors this week. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. If you're a guest of ours, we hope that you've already felt just a very warm welcome today. What we would ask for everyone to do is to grab the connection card that's just in the pew in front of you. If you're a guest, if you would fill that information out, what we'll do is we will call or text or whatever you this week. We'd also ask that on the back, if you have a prayer request, whether you're a member or a guest, if you would fill out your prayer request, just know that we will be praying for you this week, whatever requests you make. Now, let me ask everyone to stand, find someone that you do not know, and give them a very warm welcome.
a great job, boys and girls. Let's give them another hand. Amen. Let's stand together and continue to worship. An old gospel song, Thank You, Lord.
I can hardly speak, peace, soul.
Let's sing it this morning. Holy, holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy.
Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, bless their Trinity. Holy, 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 all the saints adore thee, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea.
The greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus.
And we cry, holy, holy, holy.
And we cry, and we
cry.
The greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus.
And we cry, holy, holy, holy.
And we cry, holy, holy, holy.
And we cry, holy,
holy, holy.
Is the Lamb.
And we cry, holy, holy, holy.
And we cry, holy, holy, holy.
And we cry, holy, holy, holy.
Is the Lamb.
Amen. Praise God. You may be seated.
Thank you, Charles. So at the beginning of the year, we had the special privilege of hosting the Livingstons. Mike, if it keeps up like this, I'm going to go straight to this, okay? All right. So we were had the special privilege on Sanctity of Life Sunday to host the Livingstons. The Livingstons live in Phnom Penh, Cambodia. And in Phnom Penh, Cambodia, they work as human trafficking abolitionists. So God is at work in their labor. And really, as a staff, we started to pray about joining them in their work, and we felt like the Lord was leading us in that way. So we're going to be taking the first of what I hope is many trips to Phnom Penh, Cambodia, to help prevent human trafficking. The trip will be August 27th to September 4th. It will cover Labor Day, so that if you have to take off work, maybe you'll have to take off a little bit less. So if you're interested in going, and really what we are looking for is we're looking for a group of between 6 and 8. It can't be an enormous group because we can't draw too much attention to ourselves. So what we're looking for is people with skills, right? So I'm just looking at a room of people with skills, right? Especially those who maybe have skills as a retired teacher. Maybe you're a current teacher, right? And you'll be able to take that time off. We're also looking for people who have some healthcare experience in their background, or even if you know to say ah whenever you put in the thermometer, okay? If you can do that, that's a skill, okay? So we're just looking for people, some who have those skills and others like me who will help people who are skilled, right? I don't have any skills, okay? So next Sunday, after this service concludes, we're going to meet in room 212, which is just right over there, after the service, and have an information meeting. So we would love to be able to have too many people who want to go, and so we have to schedule a second trip, okay? So if you're interested, pray about it and ask the Lord if he would have you go. And if he does, we would be very, very excited to have you with us. Now this week, we're starting a new sermon series that's a little bit more, or supposed to be more, than a sermon series. It's called Tell Someone, and it's based on a book by Greg Lowry. So Greg Lowry is a pastor and evangelist in Southern California. His ministry does gospel harvests. They have one this summer or this fall in Dallas. And so he is gifted at sharing the gospel. And so Lifeway put out a book called Tell Someone. And it's really the idea is that you, yes, even you can share the good news. So through Tell Someone, our goal is to share the gospel 500 times in the next 6 weeks, okay? You'll see that if you will find in your bulletin, you'll see this Tell Someone, Evangelism Simplified. It's way too wordy. We pastors, we don't know how to do white space. So it has got a little bit of an explanation about what our goal is, the plan to reach our goal, what we'd like for you to do, and even the fact that we'll start selling this book next Sunday at the Connect desk so you can read along with the messages. Don't read ahead or you'll read the sermon. Right, so just be always 1 week behind, okay? And just think, man, Lowry, you heard Mark and just wrote a chapter. It was so good. So, again, I don't believe that a pastor should just tell us what to do, right? And pastors are gifted at telling people what to do. This morning, I missed Bryce and Bill and Chris because I had no one to tell what to do. I had to go and do it. And I thought, man, I wore tennis shoes, if you saw me, for the first, I got here at 6:45, which, thank you, Bryce and Chris and Bill, for doing that. And I wore my tennis shoes as I went throughout the building. And do you know we have a lot of rooms? We have a lot of rooms in this building. And the light switches, I'm going to have to talk to those three guys. We're going to have to put the light switches in places that make sense. I got about 1,000 extra steps this morning. Just finding light switches, right? The preschool area, your light switch isn't in the preschool area. Yeah, I had to go find it, right? These buildings, that don't make sense. So thankfully, the lights are on eventually. And I missed them, so I'm ready for them to be back. Hopefully they won't face any trials or tribulations this week. So again, the goal, let's just get back to what we're trying to do here, right? All right, let's bring it back. That's hard for me. Pastors shouldn't just tell people what to do, right? We should also equip and hold accountable. So when we say, hey, I want us to share the gospel 500 times in the next 6 weeks, I shouldn't just then assume that you will know how to go out and share the gospel. So there are going to be 3 Tell Someone trainings. There's going to be one this Saturday, March 24th at 9 a.m. There will be one Saturday, April 7th at 9 a.m. And there will be one Saturday, April 21st at 9:30 a.m. Now, the idea here is that, the old adage says what, 20% of people in the church do 80% of the stuff, right? So here's the deal. I think the reason behind that is because 20% of the people in the church can do 80% of the work. Because we never challenge the church in something big enough that requires 100% of the church to do it. Now look around the room. Thank you, Joe. Look around the room. There are not 500 people in here. And even those people, right? So we've got, you know, some kids and carriers, right? We got some kids that can't talk yet in this room. They'll still be heard this morning, which is wonderful. They're not going to share the gospel. So do not look around the room and think, I'm so excited for people like Charlie, who's going to share the gospel, for Mandy, who's going to go out and share the gospel, for Joe, who will go out and share the gospel. You cannot do that and us reach 500. Each of us are going to have to share the gospel in order for us to reach 500, okay? So it needs all of us, 100%. Really, even if you're a guest today, we need you as well. It's going to take like 120% for us to do this, okay? So plan to share the gospel. Come to one of those trainings. Make it a priority. For those who are in need of childcare, like my family, on April 7th for the training, there will be childcare that morning. There's a sign-up sheet at the Connect desk for those who are in need of childcare on April 7th. So we don't have an excuse, okay? We need to go out and we need to share. And over the next 6 weeks, it's my job on Sunday morning to convince you that you are a part of the solution. That the task lies with us. So let me encourage you to open your Bibles. Turn in your Bible apps to Luke 15. And in a moment, we're going to start in verse 1. The story goes that one day, a man and his family go to the beach. Just him, his wife, and his three little kids. And they're having a wonderful time. Suddenly, the husband turns to his wife and says, "Honey, where are the kids?" And she says, "I don't know. I thought you were watching them." So they both jump to their feet and they race around madly. They find one, they tie him to their chair, and say, "Don't move." They start searching again, and they find the second one. After finding the second one, the husband turns to his wife and says, "Okay, let's go." And she says, "But we've only got two. There's still one missing." In which the husband replies, "That's good enough." Of course, that's not good enough. Very few, hopefully, if any dads, would feel that way, right? Parents would fervently search for that third child. They would find others to go with them, to go look for him, in order to find that last child. We would search frantically for someone who is physically lost, but we don't always have the same burden for those who are spiritually lost. Greg Lowry, in the book Tell Someone, he writes, "It's been said, there is one thing that believers and non-believers have in common. They are both uptight about evangelism." And that's true, right? When it comes to sharing the gospel, it seems that we plan for failure more often than we plan for success. So we don't even try. And some statistics tell us that 95% of all Christians have never led another person to faith in Christ. As I shared last week, if we applied the findings of Send Denver, of a missions group called Send Denver, to Aurora, just the city of Aurora, there are at least 228,962 people who live in our city without faith in Jesus Christ. And how dare us say that's good enough? They're like the lost third child. They're in need, desperate need, for someone to find them. Now, thankfully, Jesus isn't content for anyone to remain lost. He is searching for them, just like the shepherd in today's story, in today's parable, searches for the lost sheep. So let's read together. Luke 15, verses 1 through 7. And it says, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to hear him." And the him is Jesus. "The Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.' And so Jesus told them this parable. 'What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. When he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors and says to them, "Rejoice with me, for I found my sheep that was lost." Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who needs no repentance." Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful for your word. Jesus, we're thankful that you're not content with a 99, because if you're content with a 99, I would not have ever been saved. If you were content with a 99, not anyone in this room would have ever been saved. But you sought and you found the one. And you still seek for those who are lost today. Father, I pray that your burden becomes our burden. That what breaks your heart will break our hearts. That empty pews across our city, across our state, across our nation will break our heart and we'll be driven to see them filled. Not just here, because we're not just interested in ourselves, but around our city, our state, our nation, and our world. That the lost will be saved. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. So our passage starts with Pharisees and scribes grumbling over the fact that Jesus, how dare he, eats with tax collectors and people they deemed to be sinners. Now the Pharisees and scribes hated tax collectors, because tax collectors worked for the Roman Empire. And during Jesus' days, the Romans were those who occupied, they conquered, and occupied the Jews' homeland. And some of the tax collectors even exploited their other fellow Jews for their own financial gain. So the Pharisees and scribes, if you don't know who they are, they're simply this. They are the religious leaders of Jesus' day. They're the pastors, the professors, the seminarians of Jesus' day. And they just couldn't understand why in the world would Jesus eat with people that they regarded as unfit, unworthy, as outcasts. So the biases of the Pharisees and scribes against sinners reveal just a fundamental misunderstanding of God. They were supposed to be the ones that knew God the best, but they did not believe in a God who seeks and who saves those who are lost. And what they had a hard time understanding is that God is a seeking God, a God who takes the initiative to reach the lost. And tell someone, Greg Lowry wrote, "I have found that the happiest Christians are the evangelistic ones. And I have also found that the unhappiest Christians are the nitpicky kind." And we see that truth played out in our passage today. The nitpicky Pharisees and scribes had no interest in the salvation of the tax collectors and sinners. And so the first thing we have to grapple with today is just simply this. On whose side are we? Who do we have more in common? Are we the evangelistic kind, or are we the nitpicky? Are we the shepherd, or are we the Pharisees? Now, one thing that should help us, if we find ourselves having more in common with the Pharisees and the scribes, one thing that should help us is simply this, that our heart should be burdened because we remember, or you remember, your past. you remember your past. There was a time in your life, a time in my life, that we were like the tax collectors and sinners, that we did not have a relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ, because we had yet to decide to follow Jesus. But we came to faith, and then something happened. Time passed, and we forgot what it's like to be a lost sheep. In some respects, all of us have something in common with the Pharisees and the scribes. While we may never out loud question the evangelistic efforts of another like the Pharisees and scribes are doing, most of us have lost a burden, to share the gospel. We're just okay with the fact that people will die and spend eternity without God. In other words, the flame for evangelism, our flame for the gospel has extinguished. Now, it's easy to determine when something is on fire, right? It's pretty easy to figure out that something's on fire, right? What are the characteristics? Smoke, right, Andy, yeah. Smoke, flames, heat, right? It's really easy to figure out who's on fire for evangelism. Right? They're constantly talking about their lost friends and neighbors. They're constantly telling stories about when they shared the gospel. When something is aflame, it usually ignites other material. But any fire that does not spread will eventually go out. And a Christian without evangelism is a contradiction in terms. Just as a fire that does not burn is a contradiction. A fire burns, a Christian shares the gospel. So we have to reignite a passion for evangelism. So again, there's 228,962 in Aurora, 66.3% of Aurora, and at least 2,721,900 in the Denver metro area who need us to tell someone. 2,721,900 in the Denver metro area who need us to tell them about Jesus. Now, if that doesn't burden you, if that doesn't at least give you pause and say, wow, I don't know what will. But there's a comfort. There's a comfort found in that number, that in that number somewhere are harvesters who have yet to be harvested. Okay? That they're evangelists who have yet to even come to faith. We don't have to share the gospel with everyone. Right? You don't have to share the gospel with 2,721,900. But you do have to share the gospel. So that the person you share the gospel with, right, what does the Great Commission tell us? Therefore, go and make disciples. We're to baptize and then to teach how much? All that Jesus commanded us. So the beautiful thing is that in Aurora, someone who is not a Christian today could become the next Billy Graham or even the next Billy Ingram. Okay? They could have an enormous platform like Billy Graham, or they could have a platform like Billy Ingram and share the gospel in our community. You'll see that Bill has already told someone. You can see it because Bill likes to put his name on it too. I wasn't sure if that's because he needed to hear it when he told it, right? So as we share the gospel, as we then make disciples, we get co-workers, co-laborers, co-harvesters to go out and to tell someone. We will tell someone and then train someone to tell someone. Okay? You follow that? We will tell someone and then train someone to tell someone. And God will use us if we obey Him to light a spark that will spread a flame throughout our city. Now, let's look back again at verse 4. In verse 4, Jesus says, What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? So notice that the shepherd isn't content with the 99. He goes after the one that is lost. And if that sounds bizarre, just think about if you had lost 2 kids, or if you had lost 3 kids and you found 2, you'd still go after the one. He goes after the one that is lost. He doesn't stop when he's tired. He doesn't stop when the sun goes down. He goes out until he finds it. And friends, we're to match those efforts. We're to match the efforts of the shepherd who sought after the lost sheep. Therefore, we are to take the initiative to reach the lost. We're to take the initiative to reach the lost. Now, some years ago, I read this story this week. A former astronaut took over as the head of a major airline. And his goal, he was determined to make the airline service the best in the country. One day, as the new president walked through a particular department, he saw an employee resting his feet on a desk, while the telephone on the desk rang incessantly. "Aren't you going to answer the phone?" the boss demanded. "This isn't my department," answered the employee nonchalantly, apparently not recognizing his new boss. "I work in maintenance." And the boss responds, "Not anymore." Here's the scary thing. If we were to take a vote this morning, not with our hands, because we would lie, but do a ballot, a closed ballot, you wouldn't have to write your name on it. How many of us would say, "I just don't feel like evangelism is in my department"? You know, I serve in children's ministry, or you're a blessed saint that's with the 2-year-olds, right? You serve in the youth. You help out with middle school boys, which, again, God bless you. Right? You play an instrument, you sing in the choir, you pass out plates, you greet people. How many people in this room would say, "You know what, evangelism, that's just not in my department"? But evangelism isn't just another department of our faith. It's the expectation of our Savior. We need to be a people who take the initiative. Paul in Romans 10:17 tells us, faith comes from hearing, and hearing from the Word of God. No one becomes a Christian by accident. There is no one who's going to stand before Jesus, and Jesus is going to say, "Tell me the story of when you became a Christian," and they're going to say, "You know, it just kind of happened. Oops, I became a Christian." No one. No one is born a Christian. No one inherits Christianity. No one becomes a Christian by coming to church a lot. No one becomes a Christian by giving to the church a lot. There is no, "Oops, I just became a Christian." It has to come from hearing the gospel. And there's only one Paul, right? There is only one Paul that God just sort of shows up on the Damascus roads and says, "Paul, follow me." Okay? So the rest of the people, the rest of the Christians from all time had to hear the gospel to receive the gospel. Someone had to tell them. So we must do all that we can to share the gospel with others, to be a people who seek and share the gospel with the lost. We are the ones to take the initiative. The shepherd didn't just put up his lawn chair and wait for the sheep to find him, right? And have the sheep wander up and say, "Are you, right? What does that book say? Are you my mother?" Right? That don't happen. Right? So what do we prefer to do? Right? Here's our get out of jail free card for evangelism. We like to have the idea that, you know what? I'm just going to be a Christian And I'm just going to wait for someone to ask, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Right? We're just going to open our lawn chair. We're going to set it out in the field and wait for the lost sheep to find me. But that's not what the shepherd does. The shepherd goes. Jesus doesn't say, therefore, wait. Therefore, stay. He says, therefore, go. And so we can't wait for the lost sheep to find us. We have to go. You could be the greatest Christian since Jesus. Okay? And only one person walked up to Jesus and said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Right? One person walks up to Jesus and says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? So if Jesus lives in a particularly Jesus way, and it only happens for him once, why do we think that all we have to do is wait and somebody will ask us? Because I don't know about you, I'm not the second best Christian since Jesus. We must do all that we can. We must take the initiative to share the gospel with others. Now, one, that's all I'm asking you to do. It's once. Share the gospel once in the next 6 weeks. With the hope that our church will become a church that shares the gospel. Not just in the next 6 weeks, but, you know, we just sort of start to have a habit of sharing the gospel, a culture of evangelism. And here's a beautiful thing. Here's what Jesus tells us, that when we share the gospel, we discover how we can cause joy in heaven. This is what Jesus tells us. We can cause joy in heaven. In verse 7, Jesus says there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous who need no repentance. There is more joy when something is found than when there is no change in status. Those who recognize where they stand before God and respond accordingly are the cause of great joy in heaven. The possibility for such a reversal is why Jesus reaches out and why he asks us to reach out. And when a sinner repents, God rejoices. Now, have you ever seen the look of pure joy? Just the look of pure joy. 2 years ago, my family went to Disney World. And it was the first time that Jonathan was tall enough to ride on a roller coaster, an actual roller coaster, right? Not the weenie, wimpy roller coasters, but an actual Big Daddy roller coaster. We got on Expedition Everest at the Animal Kingdom, and he had some initial trepidation, right? Especially as you're going up, and there's, you know, there's a few things that can strike fear in a kid better than that chink, 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 chink as you're going up, right? Because you know what's about to happen. And after his initial trepidation, Jonathan laughed. That's an understatement. Jonathan cackled. That's an understatement. Jonathan busted a gut. He was laughing so hard. He discovered the joy of a 75-mile-per-hour roller coaster, and he laughed, just like his papa does, just like my dad does, for the whole ride. And then when we were done, you know what he said? Let's do it again. You expect to bring your kids joy at Disney World. But what we can discover today is that we can bring joy to God. We can bring joy to God. We are called to action Because we must appreciate just how much heaven wants us to seek, to search for those who are lost. We're called to seek and to save, to share with them. And as we do so, we bring joy to God. Now, you might sit there and think, I can't do it. Be encouraged by these words. You might say, I'm not qualified. I'm not gifted in evangelism, or I'm not talented as an evangelist. But do you want to know a little secret? Greg Laurie tells us, you are just the person that God is looking for. Not talented? Great. Not qualified? Perfect. Not talented? Amen. God likes to use people who are not gifted, not talented, not special. Because when God does something amazing through them, He is the one who gets the glory. You can do it. You can share the gospel. You can share the gospel because God is the one who brings them to faith. All we're called to do is to share. Everything else is between that person and God. Success is not in conversion. Success is in conversation. Do you hear me? You might share the gospel 100 times and not see one person saved, but guess what? Success is not in conversion. Success is in the conversation. When you have that conversation, the rest is just between them and God. And the beautiful thing is they might not respond in the moment, but it will stay with them. So you can do it because God is the one who does it. You can share the gospel because the Holy Spirit empowers you. You can share the gospel because you can bring joy to God. I remember my first ever gospel, real gospel conversation. I was in Venezuela. I was on a mission trip, and I remember this was, you know, sort of on day one of the mission trip. And we were going on this thing where we were just going door to door. We were knocking on doors, and we were saying, hey, how's it going? I'm from America. Awesome, right? They didn't always respond that way. But you would just say, hey, I'm from America, and I just want to ask you just a few questions. And you'd strike up a conversation with the person. And as you struck up the conversation with the person, you're just asking them questions about what they believe, what their confidence is in. And you'd share with them, well, you know, that's interesting, but my confidence is not in the fact that one time, a long time ago, I was baptized, right? My confidence is not in the fact that, you know, I'm at church every time the doors are open, and today I had to open the doors, right? That's not my confidence. My confidence is simply in the fact that there was a point in my life where I realized that I did not have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ, that people around me did. I saw it in my family, and I wanted the same. And so the pastor asked a question, and he said, if you were to die on the car ride home, how sure are you that you would go to heaven? And apparently I got into the car and said to my dad, who's notoriously fast in his driving, right? This was when he had, I believe it was an 85 Thunderbird. Or a 300 ZX. I don't know. He's had so many sports cars, it's hard to keep track. So I get into the car, and I tell my dad, Dad, drive safe. Because that would have been unusual for him. Okay? We lived about a mile from the church, and he always wanted to beat a minute, right? And so when we got out of the car, I said to my parents noticed something was weird was going on with me. Usually you tell dad to go faster, right? Not slow down. So what's going on? And I said to him, the pastor asked that question, and I don't know. I don't know if I had died in the car wreck where I would go. Mom and Dad, how do you know? And they told me that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. Right? I was in church all the time. I knew that Jesus died on the cross, but I didn't know why. And they said, well, you are separated from God because of the bad decisions that you make. right? Even though I was an okay kid, right? I don't want to stretch the truth. But even an okay kid, even a good kid, an outstanding kid, a great person makes mistakes, disobeys God, sins. And that those sins separate us from God. But God wasn't content for us to be separate from Him. He loves us so much that He sent His Son to die on the cross so that the penalty for my sin, I wouldn't have to pay. Jesus paid. So if I believe in Him, if I believe He died on the cross, if I believe that He raised from the grave, and then I follow Him, not perfectly, but to the best of my abilities the rest of my life, right? I believe it, I confess it, and I follow. Then no matter what happens on the ride home, my confidence is in Jesus, not in myself. And so I'm sitting there with this Venezuelan man talking through a translator. Okay? And I'm telling this Venezuelan man, here's what I did. Would you like to do the same? Do you believe that you sin and that your sin separates from you from God? Do you believe that Jesus died on the cross and rose from the grave? Do you want to tell God that you believe Him, that you believe that's true, and then not perfectly, but do your best to follow Him all the rest of your life? And that man said, yes. And I said, there's no way. No, I screwed up. Seriously. I took him through the gospel 3 times. Three times of asking him, would you like to do the same? Would you like to tell God that you know you're a sinner, you believe in His Son, you confess that you will do your best to follow Him? And he said, yes. And I said, no, I screwed up. Let's do this one more time. Until finally, the translator took over and said, Mark, stop talking. I will take it from here. And he led the man in just a simple prayer. And there's no magic in the prayer, but just a simple prayer that says, yeah, I know I'm a sinner. I believe that Jesus died for my sins, that He paid that penalty. And I commit to do my best, not perfectly, but to do my best to follow Jesus for the rest of my life. And there, on the steps of that man's house, he became a Christian. He decided to follow Jesus. Because remember, there are no oops Christians. Right? There is no one who comes to faith by accident. Someone has to tell him. And he thought by the fact that he was baptized a long time ago that he was good. But it's nothing that I do. It's entirely what Jesus does. I don't pay for my sins in baptism. Jesus paid for our sins on the cross. And so that man decided to follow Jesus Christ. Because some college student from Texas went with a group to Venezuela, and we told him. And the Holy Spirit changed him. You can share the gospel. Because if a college student from Texas can do it, you can do it. You can share the gospel because the Holy Spirit empowers you. You can share the gospel because you can bring joy to God. You can share the gospel because life change is beautiful. You can share the gospel because there was a time in which you were the lost sheep and somebody sought and found you, leading you to faith in Christ. You can share the gospel because there are at least 228,962 people in our city and at least 2,721,900 in our area who needs to hear the gospel, who needs us to be a people who tell someone. So let's do it, church. One. Let's tell one person. And as you tell that one person, I pray that you will get excited and that God will use you to tell one more. We didn't buy 500 stickers. We bought 1,000. Because we believe that evangelism is a fire. It's a spark that when catches, spreads. So let's tell someone. Because our city needs it. And because we can bring great joy to God. Let's pray. Father, we're so thankful. So thankful that you didn't stay in heaven. Jesus, we're so thankful that you loved us so much that you came to this earth, you took on our sin, our shame, God's wrath at the cross and died, only to be raised to new life, so that one day, just like you are raised to new life, just like your grave was empty, we will be raised to new life and our graves will be empty. So we thank you, and we praise you, and we confess we need your help because evangelism just doesn't come naturally to us. So help us. Help us to tell someone. Help us this week. Not to wait for someone to come up to us and say, hey, you're a Christian, tell me about Jesus, but for us to go and say, hey, I love you. I've been praying for you. Can I talk to you about Jesus? So help us. And Father, if there's anyone in this room who is just kind of hoping that they became a Christian by accident, that you will speak to them today. That today will be the day of their salvation. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. So friends, let me just say it again. There is no one born a Christian. There is no one who inherits Christianity because of who their parents are. We are not scrubbed clean by our church attendance. We are not made well by our good acts. No one becomes a Christian by accident. There are no oops Christians. So if you have not consciously, willingly, trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, all I'm asking you to do is that today. Do that today. So I've always thought of myself as a Christian, but you know what? I've never made that decision. Do that today. Two of our leaders here in the church named Jimmy and Rick, the three of us, Jimmy, Rick, and I, we're going to stand down front today as Charles leads us in song in just a moment. And we're going to be down front. We're just there. Maybe God has put someone on your heart, someone you know is not a Christian, someone who maybe even makes you a little bit nervous about sharing the gospel with them. What Jimmy, Rick, and I would love to do is to pray for you. Pray for you to have boldness. We'll even pray for ourselves to have boldness as well over the next several weeks to tell someone. We're also going to be standing down front for anyone who just in need of any other prayer. God may be talking to you. God may be convicting you. God may be speaking to you today, and you're just in need of prayer. We would love to pray with you, or these steps are open to you for prayer. If you'd like to join the church, we'd love to visit with you about it. But what would bring God joy today and God's people great joy is if you have always assumed that you're good with God, but you've never made that decision to follow Jesus, we would love to visit with you today just how to do it. So let me ask for you to stand. We're going to be standing down front. Guys, why don't y'all go ahead and move? We're here for you as Charles leads us in song.
My rest without you, I
runs deep. Your grace is more. Grace is found. It's where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Father, we never stop needing you. And what a joy it is to be in your presence, the very foundation of our lives. The blood of Jesus covers every one of us. And Father, in a few days, we'll be celebrating the resurrection life of your living Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we praise you and thank you for meeting the needs of those that belong to you. And Father, for the divine appointments you have set up for each one of us, to go to one that you're calling to yourself. What a joy that will be, because there's rejoicing in heaven, only one that has been found. All the angels rejoice. Father, we praise you and thank you for meeting the needs of your church today. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Through Tell Someone, I'm challenging our church to share the gospel 500 times. Now, I don't believe that I should just tell you what to do, but I should also equip you and hold you accountable. The equipping will be on Saturdays in March and April. So Saturday, March 24th, Saturday, April 7th, and Saturday, April 21st at 9 a.m., where you will learn how to share the gospel. You'll go out and share the gospel, and then we'll come back into the church and celebrate all that God has done. So I look forward to seeing you in your small group Bible study at one of those trainings.
We are collecting plastic eggs with a candy or a toy for our extravaganza community event. Please bring them by March 25th, Sunday. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Pastor Bill Ingram. I'm holding up a fence we used for the pumpkin patch last year. This year, we're going to use it also for the extravaganza that happens March 31st from 2 to 4. I need help putting up this fence around the grass starting around noon on the same day. So please come by and help. If you help me out, I'll buy you some pizza. Thanks.
Hey, church family, I want to talk to you about Easter weekend. It's going to start on Good Friday, which is March 30th, and we're going to have a Good Friday service starting at about 7 p.m. Would love for you to invite friends, family, neighbors, all those folks to join us for what will be a great but solemn time of worship as we celebrate Jesus' sacrifice. On that Saturday, which is March 31st at 2 p.m., here on our lawn, we'll have extravaganza, where we'll have all sorts of games, activities, fun things for kids and families to do. So make sure to invite a neighbor who you see who has a kid, a grandkid, whomever, to come and join us on March 31st. Then on Easter Sunday morning, we're going to have two services, one at 8 a.m., small group Bible study at 9:30, and our second service at 10:45, as we honor the risen King. So please invite friends, loved ones, family, whomever, to join us on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Hello, everyone. The Spirit of God was moving during the worship service. The pastoral staff will be in the prayer room right after church today. It's right outside the main doors to their left. We'll be glad to talk to you about receiving Jesus, becoming a member of the church, and praying specifically for a prayer request. So don't let the Spirit of God be quenched. Keep moving and come to the prayer room. Thank you.
Today, there will only be one pastor in the prayer room. So excited to introduce Carlene Lindstrom to y'all. Carlene is coming in the statement that Jesus is her Lord and Savior, and that she has been baptized by immersion. So Carlene, will you stand? And our church family will be excited to welcome you. Thank you. You can stand. If you want, Carlene, you can stay there. You can stand down front, whatever you're comfortable with, you know, so our people can come by and say hi. Charles?
Let's stand together as we are dismissed.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land. Climb the mountains, cross the waves. Onward tears, our Lord's command. Jesus saves,
Jesus saves.
Have a great week.